me a favor as we bow silently. Let's think for a second also about a lost comrade in arms in Volusia County. Ann McFall did an awful lot in a lot of different positions civically, most recently as supervisor of elections through 2012, and her loss at age 68 is keenly felt. Keep her in your thoughts.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
The clerk call the roll.
Councilmember Foley.
Here.
Councilmember Kernock.
Here.
Councilmember Stiltman.
Here.
I don't know if there's a word even worse. Vice Mayor Bastin.
Here.
Mayor Ornette.
Here.
Got it. Turn it up.
There you go.
So the red light means on.
Red light means on.
Okay. There's no green light. So the red light means on. If there's no red light, there's no light, that means off. Okay. With that, discussion items. Discuss the list of priorities for 2021 with the Parks and Rec Advisory Board. Mr. Manager, who's leading the conversation?
Your Parks Chair.
Parks.
Good evening. Thank you for letting us have the opportunity to meet with you again tonight. It was probably only a couple years ago when we were sat in the same room and we talked about the community center, converting our existing gym over to the community center. And it was a dream primarily brought by her. But with your help, we've been able to get to that point now where we've actually received the bids. I think the bids came in last week. And I think we're moving forward with that. So. This actually works. We like the idea that we can put this together. So we had, at our last meeting, we talked with each one of our members of the advisory committee, and we talked about what we want to see over the next several years and what our priorities are for next year and moving forward. So I'll give you a real quick list of what our priorities are. First of all, we, as the advisory board, would like to see the expansion of Corossi Park. I understand that there's some negotiations going on with about a 100-acre track, which would be north of the existing Corossi Park, and we would like to see that expanded. We were talking about possibly four more baseball fields, six soccer/multi-purpose fields, and here's one that's really important to me, is it's a permanent 5K track that we can put in that facility so that we can track more 5Ks, especially for charities in the our area, and possibly even some of the high school events could play out there as well, or run out there as well. We're hoping that the Corossi Park could also have playgrounds and green spaces with that 100 acres, and of course there will be additional parking and retention that will be part of that 100 acres if we're able to get that. That would be probably our primary that we'd like to see going forward right away. One of the reasons that this discussion came up during our meeting last week was, you know, we thought about, is this something we could push off for several more years? And really, we can't. I don't think we can. And it was the opinion of everybody on the board that we don't think we can, because if we wait that long, that land, developers will buy that land, and there will be subdivided, and there will be buildings or houses or whatever. I don't think there will be any commercial out there, but definitely there will be some development out there. So if we wait around too long, our opportunity to gather that land and to expand across the park will go quite away. Okay? Probably our number two, and we really want to see this, is the Westside Community Center. We have the land out there by the middle school already. So it's not a situation where number one is where we have to acquire the land. But with this one, we already have the land out there, but we think we need another community center out there. We think the community center on this side, on the east side of 95, is great. It's going to service a lot of kids over here. But we also know that most of the growth is going on on the west side of Port Orange. And we really think that the community center is needed out there. It will service an awful lot of kids and adults out on that side of the city. Probably our third is we really want to see creekside access so we can, you know, we can have access to our park that we have right now over on the creek. I know it's landlocked right now, but we would like to find a way. We're not sure exactly how this is going to happen, but we would like to see where we can have some creekside access and take advantage of that park as well.
Where are you talking about that?
You asked that, they just went right out of my head. Help me out.
Russell.
The Russell property.
Oh, okay, on the Spruce Creek. Understood. Gotcha.
Yeah, the Russell property on the creek there. Beautiful property. Unfortunately, we just can't have access to it. And everybody in this room knows about it. It's been going on for a long time. But I would like to see if there's any way that we can have access to that. We can kind of take advantage of that beautiful property. Next, we'll do the trail system. We know that the trail systems are going through Volusia County, to the northwest and west of us, but we would like to see the trail system in Port Orange, whether it's an east-west trail, we've discussed that a couple of times, maybe along the power line, maybe along the Fort Power Lights easement there, and we'd also like to see maybe some other opportunities for the trail system north and south through the city of Port Orange as well. And one of the last things we talked about was we'd like to see White Place, the park that we have over there on right off of US 1. White Place right now, we're not doing much there. We'd like to see that redeveloped. That's something, again, where we own the land and the redevelopment cost, we're not sure exactly what that would be, but that is something we'd like to see happen. It's not our top priority, but it is something we would like to see happen.
It's an utilized asset.
Yes. So I've talked a little bit. I'm going to go ahead and, if it's okay with you, open it up. If anybody else on the board wants to comment on anything that I've said, please feel free to go ahead and take that opportunity. Go ahead and do that.
I would like to talk about the Russell property. At one point, I believe it was at one of our workshops, we discussed possibly leasing that property out for someone to utilize a wedding venue or canoe launch or whatever the case may be. And I'm not exactly sure where that ended up or what happened to it, how it dissipated, but it was a discussion we had at one point was to do that. And I know obviously getting into it is probably our biggest dilemma, and I don't know where to even start to get that resolved, but rather we lease it or we don't lease it, I hate seeing that property just sit there empty for so long.
Another underutilized or unutilized asset.
Yes.
Yep. Would you mind introducing yourself, ma'am, please?
Oh, sorry. Maria Mills Bennett.
Thank you.
You didn't ask Mark to do that.
Well, what?
Mark Bolden. We didn't have what gender equity?
I demand.
There you go.
Yes, it's my turn. John Cameron, 1873 quarterback, Port Orange. We met last week and talked about all these goals. Appreciate that the council consistently listens to us and tries to fulfill those goals as evidenced by the community center redoing that. I think that's very important. And Susan detailed some of the other projects that are being looked at, and also very exciting, like redeveloping the skate park and all those other kind of things. I also saw that we're allowing her to go into Bushman and do some work down there, clean out some trees, and I just walked that park, and it's gorgeous, but it needs maintenance, and I'm just glad that we're also fostering community relationships to get some of this stuff done. It's really important to have that park, you know. So I think this list is great. Trails, just so you know, are the number one priority when people are asked. But all these other things on top of that, I think will have the biggest impact in Port Orange. So I would appreciate just consideration and working toward fulfilling these. Thank you.
Sean, 1739 Group 1 Boulevard. I concur with everything that's been stated so far. Just one point of clarification for myself on the trails. We're talking both walking and bike trails. Both. Okay. That's all I have.
Bobby Ball, Phoenix, Kinder. I think Mark did a good job of summarizing the other thing I would want to add as we enter into the budget cycle is to pay attention to the things that Parks and Rec talk about with regards to personnel and maintaining what we have. Being a longtime resident of Fort Orange, you know, the things that aren't the intangible things of Parks and Rec, tangible and nice support for the community and really solidifies what makes us special.
If I may add one thing that I mentioned in the meeting last week, that it's important, I think, and I understand that there is budgeting in place to maintain our playground equipment and upgrade as needed. So I would ask that continues. It's really important to have it in place and then to keep it in tip-top shape for very many obvious reasons: safety, appeal, use, all of the above. So it's a big expenditure, especially when you look at places like All Children's with that feature there. That's probably $500,000 right there, and other parks that have even smaller, but still, to maintain it and keep it going is tough. I just hope we won't defer the maintenance on that budget.
I can follow up on just with that question for the budget purposes. Appropriation impact fees, are they divvied out for newer construction, and do we also put any aside for maintenance? Where do those dollars come from for the maintenance?
Assuming you're under the detail of recreational impact fees are tied to the new growth in the capacity. So it would be related to the impacts of the new growth, and so we could go into detail on how we get our maintenance done.
Yeah, so recreation impact fees aren't used for the maintenance, like Wayne just said. So we do budget maintenance every year during our budget time, and we provide a list of projects. We're one cog in the wheel, we understand that. So, you know, as there's big decisions have to be made by the council, and you guys have big ones every year, you know, we just try and keep up the best we can with what we have and let you know what's the most dire maintenance that has to get done. And you guys have always been very supportive of Parks and Recreation and providing us the money we need. And then we also have a great grants manager who does a great job getting us some grant money to help offset some of those costs. But yeah, when we can use the impact fees on new construction, we do. We're using some of it on the rec because it's an increase in capacity, and you can use it for that also. And there's some development going on in this area. So it lines up with where you're developing, what zone has to be 5 miles from the area, and then you can use impact fees from that construction towards new construction or expansion of service. So that's kind of where we're
at. Yeah, we're a big chunk of those impact fees are going to the community development or community center expansion. What's the balance after that? After those dollars are gone?
I don't have that balance tonight. I can get it to you in chance.
That's a good question for finance, but I'm sure we'll be talking about that as we get into budget cycle. Just to put a bow on that, when you're talking about parks maintenance and rec programs, there are two sources of funding generally that take care of that. One of them is general fund, which is that those are tax dollars, and the other is a lot of them can be offset by user fees. But of course, if we're adding users and we're adding properties on the west side, then you're not necessarily adding to the taxes to you're building your tax base. So it doesn't have, even though you can spend more on maintenance without raising taxes. Theoretically. Right, Sue?
Theoretically.
There you go.
Now we've kind of seen our Christmas wish list, now we'd like to entertain any questions that you might have that we may address with this.
I'll give you one. Matter of fact, the order that you gave them in, I think, was significant as well. being under or not utilized at all. If we could divest ourselves of that asset to obtain one of the other four goals that you talked about, I don't know if that's, you know, of course, it's got to be the right opportunity. It's probably going to be a property owner in the area, and it's got to be the right timing. Because, like you said, it's probably not something that's going to get used overnight. It's not going to simply get divested overnight. But if council had a discussion, we had an opportunity to divest ourselves of that and put that towards one of the other four goals.
Well,
how would y'all feel about that?
It's funny that you should bring that up, because we actually discussed it in our meeting last week. That there was a property owner in that area that had expressed interest in the past into buying that property. One of the concerns that we have, I mean, I don't think the board would be adverse to that happening, but one of the things it does do is it takes away one of the only parks that we have in that area of Fort Rich. I know we
have a pretty big one right up the road.
True, we're going to talk about that a little later. But, you know, this one's been there for a long time. It's right behind me. If you don't know where it's at, it's right behind the adult center. It's where one of the pickleball courts are now. There's not a whole lot of uses that can be done for White Place right now because it's not real large. So yeah. Probably additional pickleball courts and maybe a playground, maybe some green spaces is probably all the room that we have for it. So. And I'm speaking for myself and not the board at this point. So if we did divest ourselves of that property and we could be assured that that property, the self-right of that property would be built towards one of these that we have on the list, I myself would probably be okay with that, but I may be outvoted on your budget. So.
And the reason why I'm asking you now is if it comes up later, sometimes you can't have it all, and sometimes in the process of figuring what you can have, you got to do a little horse trading. And before we do that, and if that opportunity comes up again, I kind of wanted to pull you guys and see what you all thought of that.
And Mayor, if I could, so the list they gave, I don't want you to think that that's all a next year list. I think when the board met with...
You don't have any magic money, son?
I think when the board met with council last time, the rec center out west was the consensus of the council and the board for 2025. So I don't want you to think that something has to be done next year. I think their priority, if I'm mistaken, please correct me, was to try and secure some land to expand north of Karasi. Not build anything yet, but at least buy the land, because it may not be there in the future.
Right.
To expand. And then
Agreed.
As grants come available and different opportunities come available, we know this is a priority. And if you all agree on the priorities, then those opportunities come up. So I don't want to think we have to budget all this next year, and get this to the taxpayers. I just think that it's just a plan as we're looking forward to the next 5 years. What opportunities may arise, and then what of these things may fit in. I know community development does a lot of projects right now for sidewalks and how they're expanding themselves. Those are trails. So when you start to think about some of those things, maybe when we're redoing some roadways, we put in some bike lanes. Those types of things might meet some of these that we can just be thinking about when opportunity arise. So I don't want you to think that their list was based just on this is what we want for next year. It's more just looking ahead and how we want to plan for the future.
That particular area where we're planning, I was some of them attached. Team over there, so
same.
You're too old for that.
I don't see it lost there. But we have a lot of senior adults in that area, right? We have some flooding issues in those areas as well, do we? Would that be an area to have a combined project of a track like we have out here at City Center, along with the retention, with a nice retention of a lot of dollars to get from the state to construct something like that?
Sure, some joint project with utilities would probably be good. We talked about a pond with a walkway around it. I think philosophy comes into this a lot too, is what is the council's philosophy on your parkland in your community? We know we have some large parks that people can get in their cars and drive to. In this community, especially if you spend any time in it, you will see that a lot of kids play in the street there. A lot of neighbors have signs out, kids at play, to slow traffic down there on Orange Avenue and in that section. So they do ride their bikes and walk. And the next closest park, really, for something like that would be Riverwalk, which means they would have to cross Dunlawton. And if anybody's ever been to the corner of Dunlawton and US 1, you know that's probably not the best place for a 9, 10, 12-year-old to be crossing. So, you know, if the philosophy is that we want to be a 10-minute drive to our parks, then we can adjust our park plan based on that. But in the past, the plan has been that we're trying to be within a 10-minute walk to our parks, and that people who do buy homes in our areas can get to a park by either walking or biking.
How would a green space work there? Because it's currently green space now, and it's just a swamp.
Yeah, so retention needs to be there. There is a canal that runs along that piece of property between the church and the adult activity center, that whole White Place Park area. That canal needs to be reestablished. There needs to be some work done there. And then the retention would definitely help with some of the water we're having in that area. It gets kind of swampy. You played on that field, T-ball, it was probably hard after a hard rain to get games in. But yeah, open green space. It used to have a small playground there. In 2009, I think we pulled that playground out. Budgets were really tight in 2009. We did not replace it. So maybe replacing something like that, it wouldn't be anything, you know, sports related or anything like that. It would be a neighborhood park for people to go to have a picnic, throw the ball around, fly a kite, go to the playground, just for the people in that 10-minute walk area. So,
how far is Bushwood Park from White Place? I think that's just about the same distance as Riverwalk.
Maybe a little less, but it's
like Commonwealth.
It's,
and you don't have to cross Bridgeway to get there.
No, but it's, I don't know how far it is to ride a bike.
It'd be a far walk for a young kid.
But it's a pretty long.
In my head, it just doesn't seem that far.
You have to go out to Commonwealth and up and then in.
Yeah.
We don't have a very pedestrian or bicycle-friendly crossing on Commonwealth at the railroad track either.
And to Susan's point, I was going to bring this up as well. There's a lot of low-income families in that area. Foundation 37 does a lot of assistance in that area, and many families don't even have a car, so they wouldn't even be able to drive to Riverwalk. I'm with Mark. I mean, I would entertain the option if it was a good enough option to possibly sell the property to use towards another project. But
I'm trying to keep our options open.
Yeah, I also think there's something to be said for having that park there for the families that are in that area, because there are a lot more kids than you actually think of in that area.
No, and I agree with that, but it's sat dormant for, what, 15 years now?
No, we just fenced it off when we did that. When they were doing the work on US 1, we made it a lay down site for GPS Civil to do that work. Uh-huh. And the idea was that some of the money they paid, we could do some design work and then maybe look at renovating that. But the pickleball courts are used still, the horseshoe courts are used, the shuffleboard is used, that open space on the other side is still used.
Specifically about the baseball field.
Yeah,
stuff,
yeah.
That,
it's just open green space. And people
everything else is
it.
Great.
Yeah. It's just, it needs a you know, if we're going to keep it, we just want to keep it to the same standard that the rest of our parks are at, which I think is the standard you guys expect, and that's kind of what we're looking at.
Any council, any other questions of Mark and his board? I'm going to tell you this. I will take these, and last year in the state of the city, a good portion of it was spent on the priorities that your board worked with us. This year, naturally, the state of the city focused on the immediate needs of getting through the pandemic and the like, but I know that we've got a lot of year left to work on these things, but hopefully by January we'll have a little bit more under our belt, so early February I will more than happily talk about these things in the state of the city to help keep moving these things forward. But certainly right now, just expanding Karasi, what you're talking about with that, the opportunity for land right now, Seal's saying get the land because they're not making any more, and once it's gone, it's gone. You're absolutely right. That's a short-lived opportunity. What else you got for us?
We were told to keep it short because you just blew the subject.
All right.
So I knew what I'm told.
We do have another item after this. That's all you got from that. We'll take a short break.
I'm sorry, I thought you were going to be coming to council for later.
I did, but I guess I forgot to.
Apparently, I slept through that. I thought you were asking if there was any questions.
I asked if council had any more questions.
Okay. I don't have any questions.
Okay.
That's a question to you.
What else is new? What you guys got?
So just a couple of comments that from the board, and I appreciate all the input with the board. The Carrasi Park thing, you know, one of the things I think when we think about parks and green spaces and stuff for the residents is we should think really big. We might not get there, but we should think that way, right? And so sometimes if you aim really high, you might miss, but you might really like where you land. So a couple of comments about trails and hiking and biking and all that kind of stuff. The one thing we should look at in this area that Wayne's staff will help us with is some kind of a vision or an opportunity at some point to become contiguous with the property the city owns off of Shuns Road. Right now, we lease a tremendous amount of property out there for hunting clubs, and which has been great. But as the municipality grows west, Daytona grows towards the south. I don't know how long into the future that will be something that is still viable and something that we should do. And the point of that is that it may be an opportunity at some point where we transition that from hunting lease property to a lot of green open space trail systems and stuff like that. And man, you talk about some cool property. I mean, there's some cool land out there, really neat stuff. So if we can look at land acquisition wish lists, if it ever gets us contiguous out there, if we're contiguous, can we annex it into the city? Because if those that don't know, we own it, but it's actually not in the city limits. So I don't know if there would be benefits to that at some point, but that's something to think about. And I'm not trying to put Wayne and his staff on the spot right now, but as I was looking at, as I was looking at some of this Google Earth stuff, some of the comments your team is in the board are making, we're not that far. You're really not that far when you look at this thing from the bird's eye view. So we might want to think, you know, long term, if we could get somewhere in the property acquisition that gets us contiguous to Moat Farm Road, where we're basically right across the street from our own land, then if annexation becomes something that's possible, what benefits may or may not be there for that. As a side note to that is one of the things I did want to put on the record is that it was really nice that the voters gave us 20 more
years of Echo.
Right. Yeah, so that's a good thing. And we shouldn't be amiss of that because, you know, yes, there's always matching dollars, but there's also chances of partnering with the county and things like that. And so it is nice that we know that some of the Echo Revolution Forever. Thank you. So it looks like what we just saw recently, there may be opportunities where we can tie in Wish Forever dollars, Echo dollars, municipal dollars, county dollars, all into a co-op project that would be something not only just for our residents, but something really nice regionally. So that's why I'm saying think really big, look at that area, you know, the baseball parks and things like that. I agree with you, that's always going to be needed. But as we look at that area regionally, I think we should also be thinking about that property on the other side of Tomoka Farms and how that could someday be tied in as a trail system. Really cool eco trail system and nature trails and all that kind of stuff. So, just a quick comment on the Wake Place. You know, I don't know that I'm ready to go one way or another on that piece of property. It's got its challenges. You know, we many years ago, maybe decades ago, the city partnered along with the police department. We had a police athletic facility that we specifically put over on that side of the city for all the reasons we're discussing. It just didn't get used. We tried and tried and tried and tried, and it just did not get used. We've talked about that piece of property ever since I've been on the council, and before councils have had conversation. And the whole thing has been, if we make the investment, is it going to get used? You know, where are we going to get the biggest impact and bang for the buck? The pickleball thing came out of nowhere, and then all of a sudden, man, you know, that turned out to be a great venture. And from what I've seen, so you can correct me if I'm wrong, it's still getting used quite a bit. And I know that continues to grow in popularity. So, you know, my point with the pickleball thing is maybe what we need to do on that property just hasn't happened yet. You know, maybe that idea hasn't come to was, or maybe that next trend or whatever. So, but you know, it's a piece of property that is got its challenges, and but I just, like, in my mind, I just can't wrap my head around what's the best course of action. And so, to the mayor's credit, I'm not building any more land, so we've got to be careful before we let go of that one. But the other nice side of that is from the challenge perspective, we do have the other city property there that borders up to US 1 and they have a facility there. And so, you know, logistically, some of the things are already in place to some degree. Parking is a challenge. You know, I remember back in those times when we were still using it actively as a T-ball field or a little league field. Man, the parking up and down that road was just horrible. The church has been a good partner, but you know, that doesn't solve everything. So that's my thoughts, man.
Drew, did you want to chip in a word? Thank you. Anybody else on council? No. In that case, let me throw
it out. I'm going to say one thing about the Shuffle property. That has been discussed several times during our committee meeting, during our board meetings as well. But we still thought, at least the information we were given, that was still quite a ways away before we could look into that. But I agree, I mean, we could get a big track out there. I know that Susan had talked about the BMX track for the kids to go and ride their bikes out there and the walking trails and everything else. And like you said, we can't get out there because the gate's locked, obviously, but we can see that good work that it looks like a really interesting piece of property. It's something that we have on our radar, but we didn't think we would turn around over the next several years.
Yeah, and I would just comment, I don't know quite a ways what it looks like anymore, right? Yeah. We just don't know the way things are going in our state and regionally. Some things that look quite a ways away might be closer than you think now. I don't know. So, but I think it's something worth keeping on the discussion and the what if scenarios you want to make.
If we could add it to the list if you want.
If you could do that. A little side note, right?
Right. Edgewater being one of the smallest cities in our county, 20 years from now, it's probably going to be one of the biggest. It's the way things change. With that, would anybody from the public care to speak on anything on Parks and Rec priorities? Come on up, Cody Andrews.
He's getting ready to donate a bunch of land, I can feel it.
Over here. Okay. Shailish Patel, 4643 South Pike Morris. I just want to say, first of all, I love the vision. I love the priorities you've set forth. I also like what the parks you're talking about. Our kids have played baseball in those parks. I think there's a good opportunity to do a lot of things, and we do a lot of work all over the state on the East Coast related to parks. And I don't know if Susan can think about this or whoever's in charge of Parks and Rec. I think one of the things that I see lacking more than anything is actual funding to Parks and Rec. And I'm gonna be honest about that because I see a lot of our parks are aging and there's a lot of infrastructure that is aging. And the only time we do something about it is when it's in pretty bad shape. I think funding needs to be allocated so that Parks and Rec can actually go and we can improve our facilities. There's a lot of corrosion in this area.